Hi, this is Simon with the IQRF. This video explains the key features of an IQRF network and the Iqmesh protocol when using IQRF data control transceivers. We will show you in detail how the discovery process works and how a packet is delivered throughout the network. So what are the basic features of an IQRF network? An IQRF network can operate on 3 sub-gigahertz bands, 868, 916 and 433 megahertz, with a different number of channels on each band. Default bitrate is 19.2 kilobauds. In a full mesh topology, you have just one coordinator and up to 239 nodes, while each one of them can, but doesn't have to, work as a router. Each node can work as a coordinator for his subnetwork as well, so you can have up to 239 subcoordinators with 239 subnetworks, and each of the subnetworks can have up to 239 nodes. This means you can have literally thousands of nodes in one network. Having said that, it's recommended to build up rather smaller networks for faster and more flexible communication, deployment and maintenance. In each network you can use up to 240 hops, where each hop takes from 30 to 50 milliseconds depending on how much data out of the 56 bytes available you put into a packet. Communication in the main network is synchronized, whereas subnetworks are usually used for asynchronous communication, such as alarm messages or commands from remote controllers. We will discuss asynchronous messages in detail in the following tutorial. The maximum range you can reach with IQRF transceivers strongly depends on the environment and the conditions of your application. In very general, you can expect tens of meters indoor and hundreds of meters outdoor. On the iqrf.org/rf-simulation, you can find an interactive calculator to get the first idea of the range you can reach in your specific application. So, how do you build up this kind of network? First of all, you need IQRF data control transceivers that are represented with these gray bullets. As you can see, each module has a unique 4-byte module ID, which is especially important for the modules where you upload a hardware profile for a coordinator. The MID is then used for the network ID, so you cannot control the network with another module. You upload a node hardware profile to the modules which should operate as nodes. If you want to use subnetworks, then you need to upload the coordinator node hardware profile. Now you need to add your nodes to the network of your coordinator and assign them with the logical address. This process is called bonding. The last node should work in a subnetwork, so you need to bond it to the subcoordinator. By the way, you send the bonding command to the subcoordinator from the main coordinator. Let's say the devices number 1 and 4 are temperature sensors running on battery, so we don't want them to work as routers and we switch the routing off. This could be done very easily in the TR configuration in the IQRF IDE right here. We place the nodes to their final positions and here you can see the wireless links between the nodes. Now we have to set up a routing structure which is done through the automated process called discovery. In the discovery, the coordinator asks, "Hey, whoever can hear me, please let me know." In our case, it will be node number 3 and 6 who answers. Number 4 will not react since the routing on this node was switched off. Then, because number 3 is lower than number 6, number 3 will get virtual routing number 1 and number 6 will get VRN 2. Why we need the VRN will be explained shortly. There is no other routing node in the direct range from the coordinator, so the routing zone number 0 is completed. By the way, zone number 0 means that you can get to these nodes with no routing hops. Then the coordinator assigns node number 3 to discover nodes in its neighborhood and assign them with VRN higher than 2. Number 3 discovers number 2 and assigns it with VRN 3. Number 6 will not react because it has been discovered already. In the same logic, number 6 discovers number 5 and assigns it with VRN 4. In this way, we get the zone number 1 completed. Number 1 is not discovered since the routing on this module was switched off. Now we have the network ready, so let's show how the packet is delivered and why we need the VRN. In order to avoid packet collisions, Iqmesh protocol operates in time slots according to the VRN. So in the time slot number 0, the coordinator sends out a packet and it's received by nodes number 3, 4 and 6. By the way, the time slot number 0 can start any time, so basically the communication is synchronized based on the received packet from the coordinator. There is no absolute time synchronization of the network. Following this logic, in the time slot number 1, it will be only the node with VRN1, so node number 3, who forwards the packet. Node number 6 waits for the second time slot and then transmit the packet. In this way, the packet is routed by the nodes number 2 and 5 as well. Response from the node is coming back in the very opposite way. This routing protocol is called directed flooding and is patented by IQRF, the manufacturer of the IQRF technology. So, what does it mean to you? It's pretty obvious that each node receives redundant packets, so the probability of losing a packet is very low. Since VRN is stored in the system EEPROM, in a case of reset, there is no need of any self-healing process and the network is ready to operate again in a matter of milliseconds. To calculate how much time it takes to deliver a packet, you just multiply number of hops by the time of each hop. Time to get a response is the same, so you need to multiply your results by 2 to get a complete time of delivering a packet and getting a response. You can see that the Iqmesh algorithm is very robust, so even in very bad conditions you will get your message delivered. In our case, we have 5 out of 11 links lost and the message is delivered successfully to all nodes anyhow. In the following tutorial, I will show you how you can use asynchronous communication and how you can effectively collect data from all nodes using the fast response command. So, make your products wireless. Communication throughout the IQRF network is very reliable, and moreover, it's simple. This video is just a small piece of a complete IQRF video tutorial set. To get a full picture and understanding of the IQRF technology, please watch previous and following IQRF tutorials.